Okay, so Lindsay said, I need help with meditation. I struggle to focus. It's like my mind has 100 tabs open all at the same time. Does anyone have a go-to guided meditation or any ideas about this? And then there's a whole slew of comments underneath that. And I like that analogy, right, of having 100 tabs open. And but you can't really, because you can only think one thought at a time. So, even though those tabs are there, you can only think one thought at a time. Oh, hi, Lindsay. I'm glad you're here because I want to look after your question. So good. Awesome. I like that. Okay. So I've posted the Zoom link. It's in the events tab as well as on the group wall. If you guys want to join me on Zoom, you can. All right. So the most important thing I think is to understand the purpose of meditation. And the purpose of meditation is to withdraw our five senses from the world so that our mind can go dormant. See, our mind is doing its job all the time, and its job is to take all this information that we are collecting from things that are happening around us and what we are doing, and organizing that information in a manner that we can define our preferences. So, our mind then is active all the time. And because our mind is active all the time, our beliefs are active all the time. And whenever something happens in our world or around us that we have a belief about, our mind goes and finds that belief and activates it. So I like the analogy that we started with, the analogy of a computer, because this is also how I explain beliefs. So we have two types of beliefs. One type of belief is our active belief. Active belief, it is like the RAM of the computer. So the RAM and the ROM are two different types of memory. I don't remember exactly which one is which. This is long time ago when I was in school. But I know that there's an active memory that you can access all the time. And then there's that stuff that you have stored on the hard disk. So when you go and search for the stuff that's on the hard disk, you open it and now it's part of the active memory. And that's how our beliefs function as well. We have a set of beliefs that we don't tap into on a day-to-day basis. They are dormant. And there are active beliefs that we do tap into all the time. For example, my belief is I must wake up at so and so time in order to get everything done that I need to get done before I leave the house in the morning, right? And some of those things are I need to feed my cat and my dog and my children and get my lunch ready and stuff like that. So my belief is that I have to do this in the morning every day. That's an active belief. It's there all the time. But a dormant belief is my belief about the personality of an aunt that I haven't seen in the past 20 years. It's dormant. My opinion of her personality is dormant because I'm not thinking about her on an everyday basis. It's stored on my hard disk. But soon as someone brings her name up, my mind is going to go and access all that information that I have stored about her, and now all of that becomes part of my active memory. So, listen carefully, this is important. Our active beliefs are always swimming in our head. They are what constitutes our self-talk. And so we have to stop the chatter in our heads in order to make these beliefs go dormant. Because understand that these beliefs, these active beliefs, interfere with what you want to manifest. Because unbeknownst to you, and I say unbeknownst because if you knew, you wouldn't be doing it. But there are beliefs that get in the way of what you want. If you knew they were getting in the way, you would have tossed them out a long time ago. But you don't know. And some of these beliefs are in your active memory, some of these are in your dormant memory, but they're both there. For just 15 or 20 minutes a day, we want to take the beliefs that are active and make them dormant. Because some of them are getting in our way. Dormant beliefs do have an impact, but not as much. Their vibration is not as strong because we're not activating them all the time. But my active beliefs are activated and they're vibrating all the time. My dormant beliefs are not vibrating that strongly. So what I want to do is for 15 or 20 or 30 minutes a day, I want to take my active beliefs and make them dormant. Because when I do that, now they're not getting in my way, in the way of what I want to manifest. So I create a 15 to 20 minute window every day during which the beliefs of my inner being are the strongest vibration that's coming from me. So our inner being is always vibrating as well. That's a third element. Is vibrating, but that vibration is being blocked by our active beliefs. When we remove our active beliefs from the scenario, the active beliefs of our inner being become dominant, vibrate strongly, and therefore bring us the manifestations that we want. Because when we say, I want this thing, our inner being says, yes, it's done. And we don't have the benefit of that because we are not looking at it from that point of view. Our inner being starts enjoying the vibrational reality and we keep waiting for the physical reality. Okay? So when we remove ourselves, our mind, from the game, our inner being dominates and the benefit of that is huge. Now I want to give you something really, really important. Very few people know this. Very few people teach this. I teach it all the time. I'm one of those few people. Here's what I want you to know. You only need 2 minutes in that space that we call meditation. You only need 2 minutes. The 15, 20, 30 minutes are the work that we do in order to create that window of 2 minutes. The 30, 20, 15, whatever time you've set aside is what we do to get the active memory to stop spinning and go dormant, so that we can allow our inner being 2 minutes to send out a dominant vibration. And so What I want to say to you, Lindsay, is that if you manage to get to that space that we call meditation, your job's done. You know, nobody spends half an hour there. With practice, you can, but you don't have to. And the thing that makes meditation powerful is getting your head out of the way while you are working on reprogramming the way your mind thinks. If you can just get it completely out of the way for a few minutes, the benefit of that accumulates and becomes huge. So remember that that is what meditation is all about, and keep it simple instead of overcomplicating it. I'm not looking to turn my head off for half an hour. I'm only looking for 2 minutes of space. So much easier, isn't it, to say I only need 2 minutes than to say, oh my God, I have to turn it off for a whole hour. Okay, now, people confuse mindfulness with meditation. Remember this very simple rule. As long as any one of your five senses is engaged actively with the world, your mind is not going dormant. You're slowing it down, but it's not dormant. As long as your five senses are engaged with the world, your mind is still active. So mindfulness is the path to meditation, but on its own, mindfulness is not meditation. Because your mind is still working on that information you're collecting from the world, and therefore it's looking at all your sets of memories saying, where are the beliefs that I can use in order to take this information that I'm getting and put it into a box, organize it, to make it useful. So, however, mindfulness slows us down. So when instead of paying attention to thousands of things that are happening around us, the light, the temperature, the environment, and things that we are contemplating in our heads, when we just pick one or two things and we give our mind an instruction, and the instruction is, all I want you to do for the next 15 or 20 minutes is to focus on these things that I'm telling you to focus on. Now your mind lets go all the other stuff, because your mind is your tool. It will do what you tell it to do. It's your tool. You are not the tool. So when you tell your mind, I want you to think about baby unicorns, then your mind will think about baby unicorns. And then it will try to get away. Just like that little child who is in a classroom and they hate the studies and they can't wait to get away from it. So they start fiddling. And the teacher says, come back. Right? So this is what happens in meditation. You sit there and you don't want to keep focusing on baby unicorns. You want to go do something else that's more interesting. You've got everything you wanted out of this unicorn, this picture of the baby unicorn. There's no more fun to be had by looking at the horn and the colors. There's no more fun to be had I already know it's got a horn, it's 6 inches, whatever. I've got that information. Come on, let's get some more information from the world. That's what your mind wants to do. And so your mind starts wandering, but then because you've given your mind an instruction, you've said, don't go anywhere, focus on the baby unicorn. So guess what? Your mind reminds you, it kicks in. Oh, but you said you wanted to focus on the baby unicorn, but there's more interesting stuff going on over there. Can I go there? And your answer has to be no. Come back. Focus on the baby unicorn. Because when you do that, you cut out all the interferences and you withdraw. Eventually, your mind becomes so bored, it has no more information to collect because you're looking at the same thing again and again. Or you're repeating the same words again and again. Eventually, your mind says, this is bloody boring. I think I'll just go to sleep. And that's when your mind goes dormant. But it doesn't stay dormant for very long. However, it does give you that window which is sufficient for your inner being to become dominant. And when your inner being is dominant, that vibration is so strong that those things that you've been waiting for, they come towards you like a stampede in that 2 minute window. And slowly that 2 minute window starts becoming a 5 minute window and then a 10 minute window because you love going there. It's so nice down there. But nobody wants to stay there forever because that was not our life purpose. We did not come into this earth space reality to meditate and withdraw our mind. We came here to engage our mind. So when we are in meditation for excruciatingly long periods, we are not living our life purpose. So don't do that. Okay? Now, the next most important thing to understand is that there are three learning modalities. People have three types of main ways of taking information from their environment and organizing it. And we know what they are. They are visual, auditory, or kinesthetic. So your dominant senses, for some people, their dominant sense is the sense of hearing. That is why words are important to them. They like to read. Other people don't want to read. They just want to watch because they're visual. Some children learn by your telling them, and other children will never learn from being told. They need to see. My daughter has to read it. My son has to see it. They're different. And kinesthetic are those people who need to do it in order to learn it. So when we sit down for meditation, knowing this is really helpful. For example, for me, I know that my absolute most strong sense is auditory. That's why I'm the author, that's why I speak, because I'm auditory. The world, I can make sense of the world in terms of words. And then there are those people who make sense of the world in terms of pictures. That's what my book Thrive is all about, because guess what? My second most strongest sense is visual. I'm auditory and visual. I therefore know that I need to give my eyes something to do and my ears something to do in order to get them focused enough to be able to go into meditation. And that is mindfulness. Mindfulness is the tool that takes us into meditation. Mindfulness means I'm just going to focus on this one thing and not let my mind wander. So for me, I have to engage my eyes and my hearing. I do that by giving myself something to see in my mind's eye and something to hear in my mind's eye. So I close my eyes and I will repeat numbers backwards. That's my favorite way of doing it. I usually start at either 87 or 67 and work backwards, and I don't even get to 40. I'm gone somewhere in between. But the benefit of using numbers to me is that on the screen of my mind, I see the number flash, 67, 66, 65, and I'm saying the number. So now I have engaged my vision and my sense of hearing, and I've engaged them, I've given them something to do. And because I've given them something to do, which is internal, I have withdrawn them from the world. And because I've withdrawn them from the world, pretty soon my mind is going to get bored, because it's going to be like, this is, I'm not doing anything here. There's nothing new here. And that's what makes it easier to use that same, I call it a thought anchor. Use that same thought anchor to go into meditation every time. Because as soon as I grab my thought anchor, the mind says, oh, this is boring. I better go to sleep right now. There's no need for me to wait 10 minutes. I'm not going to waste 10 minutes on this. I'm going right now. I'm done. Tell me when it's time to come out. Right? And so that's why meditation becomes easier the more you do it. Now,